Welcome to Cherryfield Baptist Church. May God bless you as you worship Him today in His presence and alongside of the church at Cherryfield. We're going to start today with a call to worship from Psalm 119, verses 137 to 144. It says this, O Lord, you are righteous, and your regulations are fair. Your laws are perfect and completely trustworthy. I am overwhelmed with indignation, for my enemies have disregarded your words. Your promises have been thoroughly tested. That is why I love them so much. I am insignificant and despised, but I don't forget your commandments. Your justice is eternal, and your instructions are perfectly true. As pressure and stress bear down on me, I find joy in your commands. Your laws are always right. Help me to understand them so I may live. Let's pray together today. Father God, we thank you for what this reading of your word has told us today. That, Lord, your promises are thoroughly tested, that your instructions are perfectly true, and your laws are always right. We give thanks, God, because your word is an extension of who you are and what you do. Your word is a revelation into the God of all wonders, the one that we worship. And Father God, we pray that as we enter into worship this morning, that we would remember that your word reveals your character, your works, and your ways. We praise you, God, as the God over all things. We praise you, Lord, for Jesus Christ, the one in whom we have found salvation, healing, hope, and love, the one who gives joy and peace and forgiveness and grace. Thank you for him. Fill us with your Holy Spirit today and bless our service. And forgive us, Lord, of our sins, personal sins, corporate sins, Lord, we pray that you would help us to reflect the righteousness that you give and the righteousness that depends on faith in Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
The title of this morning's message is The Great Prostitute. We have a saying in our culture, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Basically, this means that what one person perceives as beautiful is not necessarily beautiful to another person. This understanding of beauty and attractiveness does not stand in the spiritual realm. In fact, Revelation 17 suggests that without spiritual wisdom and understanding from God, we fall to the seduction of what this chapter calls the great prostitute. You see, beauty needs to be redefined by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And today we're going to discover why that is so. Let's look at Revelation 17. The words to this chapter will be on the screen. This is the word of God, and it says this. One of the seven angels who had poured out the seven bowls came over and spoke to me. Come with me, he said, and I will show you the judgment that is going to come on the great prostitute who rules over many waters. The kings of the world have committed adultery with her, and the people who belong to this world have been made drunk by the wine of her immorality. So the angel took me in the spirit into the wilderness. There I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast that had seven heads and ten horns, and blasphemies against God were written all over it. The woman wore purple and scarlet clothing and beautiful jewelry made of gold and precious gems and pearls. In her hand she held a gold goblet full of obscenities and the impurities of her immorality. A mysterious name was written on her forehead, Babylon the Great, mother of all prostitutes and obscenities in the world. I could see that she was drunk with the blood of God's holy people who were witnesses for Jesus. I stared at her in complete amazement. Why are you so amazed? The angel asked. I will tell you the mystery of this woman and of the beast with seven heads and ten horns on which she sits. The beast you saw was once alive but isn't now, and yet he will soon come up out of the bottomless pit and go to eternal destruction. And the people who belong to this world, whose names were not written in the book of life before the world was made, will be amazed at the reappearance of this beast who had died. This calls for a mind with understanding. The seven heads of the beast represent the seven hills where the woman rules. They also represent seven kings. Five kings have already fallen. The sixth now reigns, and the seventh is yet to come, but his reign will be brief. The scarlet beast that was, but is no longer, is the eighth king. He is like the other seven, and he too is headed for destruction. The ten horns of the beast are ten kings who have not yet risen to power. They will be appointed to their kingdoms for one brief moment to reign with the beast. They will all agree to give him their power and authority. Together, they will go to war against the Lamb. But the Lamb will defeat them because he is Lord of all lords and King of all kings. And his called and chosen and faithful ones will be with him. Then the angel said to me, "The waters where the prostitute is ruling represent masses of people of every nation and language. The scarlet beast and his ten horns all hate the prostitute. They will strip her naked, eat her flesh, and burn her remains with fire. For God has put a plan into their minds, a plan that will carry out his purposes. They will agree to give their authority to the scarlet beast, and so the words of God will be fulfilled. And this woman you saw in your vision represents the great city that rules over the kings of the world." This is the word of God. May it be blessed. Let us take a moment and pray and ask God to bless our time. Father God, we thank you for this reading of your holy word, and we ask, Lord, that you would speak to us in such a way, Lord, that we love your truth. We pray, God, that you would speak to us in such a way that you would transform our hearts and renew our minds. We pray, Lord, that you would speak to us today in such a way that you would empower the church to represent you as lights in this dark world. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. How do we allow God to keep us from the seduction of the great prostitute? We need to allow God to give us help, to show us another way, or we will be seduced by this great prostitute. So how do we allow God to keep us from that place? The first place we're going to start today is with this. Number one, let God establish in us a sense of belonging. The great prostitute is symbolized in the image of Babylon. And later on in the text this morning, when it talks about the seven hills, that was a description of Rome. And so the symbolism here, when it uses the idea of Babylon, it is really the world order, but in the specific context of Revelation, it's speaking about Rome. Jeremiah 51:13 describes Babylon as a city that dwells on many waters with much abundance and prosperity, which is parallel to the way that the great prostitute is described in Revelation 17, verses 1 and 2. The leaders and people of the world succumb to her religious and idolatrous demands to cement their own material security. Economic prosperity is tied to their loyalty to Babylon, thus connecting security to the world order instead of God. G.K. Beale defines Babylon in this way: the prevailing economic religious system, in alliance with the state and its related authorities, as it exists in various forms throughout the ages. End quote. This drives us in the church to a place of decision. To whom do I belong? Is it God or the world that has sealed me? You see, Paul addresses this in one of his letters to the churches. Ironically, it's one of the same churches that is addressed in the book of Revelation, and that is the church in Ephesus. And in Ephesians 5:18, Paul writes these words: don't be drunk with wine, because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. In the book of Revelation, intoxication is an image tied to those controlled by the immorality and idolatry and really the hard-heartedness of the world order. It is the world order that controls them. They are under its influence. However, we belong to God, and we are to be filled with the Holy Spirit. He is the one who controls us, and if he doesn't, he should. This is a significant question for you to answer today. To whom do you belong? If it's Jesus Christ, then you're going to be advancing the purposes and the gospel of his kingdom. If it is the world, then you are going to find your comfort and your security in it. To whom do you belong? And perhaps another way to ask that same question: to whom do your actions and lifestyle reveal that you belong to? The second way we allow God to keep us from the seduction of the great prostitute is this. Number two, let God establish in us a sense of security. Revelation 17, verse 3 says, so the angel took me in the spirit into the wilderness. In the Spirit connotes several different things. It describes prophetic commissioning. It echoes Isaiah 21, verse 1, which tells of Babylon's judgment coming from the wilderness. And it portrays a refuge of spiritual security and an escape from the world's allure. For the church as a community, in the Spirit brings a sense of security. According to Revelation 17, verse 4, the woman wore purple and scarlet clothing and beautiful jewelry made of gold and precious gems and pearls. This harlot or prostitute symbolizes the religious and economic realms of society that draw Christians to compromise. This compromise is one of trust. Christians place their trust in the world's security instead of in Jesus Christ when they succumb to the compromise of what the world order is seeking to seduce us with. The name of the woman in Revelation 17, verse 5, is Babylon the Great, mother of all prostitutes and obscenities in the world. This name clearly connects her to the beast that we talked about in an earlier chapter of Revelation. G.K. Beale states that Babylon is not a geographical locality, but a demonically directed economic and spiritual reality present throughout the church age, end quote. In Revelation 17, verse 6, it describes the blood of God's holy people, which symbolizes all the forms of suffering that God's people endure between the first and second coming of Jesus, and this certainly includes martyrdom. The end result of this vision is that John stares at her in complete amazement. Let's unpack what that means. John's response to this vision described here as one of amazement takes into account a number of different things. First, it takes into account his fear regarding the horror of persecution. Second, his shock at the woman's semblance of religiosity. And third, his wonder at the woman's admirable appearance. The woman is persuasive in her appearance as something religious and seductive in her appearance as something needed. We need to let God build into our lives a sense of security in Jesus. For if we don't, we're going to find that security with this great prostitute symbolized by Babylon and the world order. May God carry us too into the wilderness, his place of security for us, so that he can remove the enticements of the world, much like he did to the Israelites when he delivered them from Egypt into the wilderness. God had to bring Israel to the wilderness to remove Egypt from their hearts. And God has to bring us to the wilderness to remove Babylon from ours. The wilderness is ultimately a place of security. It gives us perspective to see that our security is in Jesus Christ, and we can trust him. It also gives us the vantage point to see the evils of Babylon and avoid her deception and seduction. If John can be amazed by this woman, and if he needed a rebuke from the angel, if some of the churches were rebuked by Jesus for loving riches and idolatry, then we need God to establish in us a sense of security in Jesus Christ. Paul understood this reality. He says in Philippians 4, verse 19, that this same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. Do you find your security in Jesus Christ? In other words, does the world lose its luster because of the security you have in your relationship to and with Jesus Christ. The third way we allow God to keep us from the seduction of the great prostitute is this. Number three, let God establish in us a mind of understanding. It goes without saying that if the Apostle John, to whom Jesus Christ gives this revelation, struggles to understand the great prostitute and her incessant evil, then we, like John, also need to have minds of understanding given to us by God. The beast displays in this text a spoof of that which is characteristic of God. In Revelation 17, verse 8, the beast is described as one who was, isn't now, and will yet come, which is a cheap imitation of the Almighty, who is described as the one who was, who is, and who is to come. What this describes is explained in Revelation 17, 10 to 12. The beast will come again in the form of coming kinds and transfers of power. The great prostitute Babylon is linked to imperialism. And so with the fall of one world order, this beast will rise again in the next one, up until the end of time, when at last this beast will rise up to be eternally judged and destroyed by God. John is describing the way that the beast demonstrates its power in recurring political empires and systems in history. The text also tells us that the great prostitute Babylon rides the beast. Tim Chester gives helpful description about what this means when he says this. Though the woman rides on the beast and rules over kings, in verse 16 they turn on her and destroy her. The city of Rome will be destroyed by the very empire it built in fulfillment of God's word of judgment. The allegiance of Rome's client rulers is an act of self-interest, and when the political climate shifts, they will be quick to shift that allegiance. End quote. John is warning Christians not to devote themselves to imperialism because political power can easily change. Much like Scripture tells us not to trust in money because of its fickle security, so John admonishes us about politics and imperialism in the same manner. The destruction of Babylon fulfills the plan and purposes of God according to Revelation 17, 17. Again, we need to have minds of understanding about these things. Rome was seductive and persuasive in her ability to deceive the minds of many, including Christians, regarding her security and trustworthiness. We saw this evidenced in Jesus' letters to the churches of Thyatira in Revelation 2, 18 to 29, and Laodicea in Revelation 3, 14 through 22. Compromise is a constant danger to the Christian. And here Jesus tells us through the angel that we need to be told the mystery of this woman and the beast and to have minds of understanding. Jesus knows that both the revelation of mystery and having minds of understanding are linked to our faith and confidence in him. This whole chapter came from John's encounter with the angel who poured out the seventh bowl in the previous chapter, the one that completed God's wrath. The angel spoke with John about the seventh bowl because Jesus deemed it necessary for greater revelation regarding this bowl. And yet, this is not the only time John warns us about the seduction of the world. in his first epistle, 1 John, chapter 2, verses 15 to 17, John writes these words: "Do not love this world, nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from this world. And this world is fading away, along with everything that people crave. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever." May God be faithful to give us minds of understanding so that we love Him more than we love the world. May we not be enticed so much by this world that we slowly lose and compromise our love for God, since indeed He is our belonging and our security, and He gives us understanding. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for this message today. And we pause, Lord, and we recognize that many times we do look for a sense of belonging, a sense of security, and minds of understanding based on the seductions and deception of the world. Lord, not everything in the world is wrong and evil. For this is, as the hymn says, our Father's world. But the world order, its culture, its systems, what it celebrates, what it worships, Lord, is so opposed to You. And God, when we allow ourselves to find our security and our belonging and minds of understanding in the world order, we compromise our faith. Forgive us, God. Forgive us for the many times that we have looked to the world order to give us what only You can give us. And awaken us, Lord, to how we belong to You. Awaken us to the truth and the reality that security is found in You, at least that which is true and full security. And Lord, help us to remember that we need You to give us minds of understanding. Thank You for this word today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. A word of benediction today. May the grace of the Lord and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.